Hey y'all, and welcome back to Graphic Content, the show where I make a design for one of my favorite wrestlers while telling you why they're one of my favorite wrestlers. And today's a little bit different because this isn't a wrestler that I've always been a massive fan of. It's just a guy that I basically knew about through the great cultural osmosis of pro wrestling. But after a recent rewatch of the first year of Monday Night Raw, he easily became one of my favorites in the form of Bam Bam Bigelow. So, in case you're wondering where all the content for the channel has been for the past few weeks, it's because, well, I was planning to do an entire retrospective on the first year of Monday Night Raw, much like I've done in the past, rewatching NXT Redemption or the guest host era of Raw. The only problem is there really wasn't that much to talk about. The first year of Raw was really just a bunch of glorified house shows that were made to promote live events and pay-per-views. I mean, there were some bright spots like the 1-2-3 Kid versus Razor Ramon and HBK versus Marty Jannetty, but for the most part it was a lot of things that I think should just be left in pro wrestling's past. But there was one person that absolutely subverted all of those expectations when he came out on Monday Night Raw. A physically imposing hulk of a man with a unique look that got in the ring, decimated his opponents, and always left an impact. And I'm of course talking about Atom Bomb. Okay, maybe not Atom Bomb, although him and Johnny Polo were actually also another bright spot of Raw for me, but that might just be the mental illness talking, to be honest with you. No, I'm talking about Bam Bam Bigelow, a guy to me that seems like the ultimate in being in the absolutely wrong era for him. He was a big man that can move like a cruiserweight, a giant beast from the east, covered in flames that intimidated anyone who stepped in his path, a guy that you could honestly easily build a company around, but in the bright, flashy neon 90s, he fell more into a background role as an upper to mid-card heel. I mean, they had him fucking feuding with Doink, which, like, no offense to Doink, but could you imagine peak of his career Bammer facing off against the likes of like Samoa Joe or Kevin Steen? Put him in mid-2000s ROH, it's print money. The first time Bam Bam shows up in the first year of Monday Night Raw is essentially the same way a lot of guys debuted back then, against the smallest, most insignificant flea of a performer they could find. A flea that would, interestingly enough, grow up to be the master of the worms, Scotty Too Hottie. And the interesting thing immediately to me about Bam Bam was just how fun his squash matches were. They weren't just, alright, you wanna see this little guy die? Instead, it was more of like a David versus Goliath story. The future Scotty Too Hottie wasn't just in there to get suplexed and tossed around, he was finding reversal after reversal. He was trying his best to outsmart Bam Bam and take down the beast with his wits, but unfortunately Bam Bam was just able to outpower Scott every single step of the way. While it showed the sheer power and dominance of Bam Bam Bigelow, it also showed that he wasn't infallible. He could be outsmarted, he could be outwitted, he could even be out-wrestled. It was an interestingly selfless style of squash match, a bout that's usually pretty one-sided. It showed to me that Bam Bam cared about the future of the business and cared about telling stories that made sense. Unfortunately, though, as the months went on, Bam Bam's squashes got shorter and his role became simply a secondary bad guy to the main heels, until eventually he was quite simply just there to be there, a bad guy for the sake of being a bad guy. He was basically just the 1993 version of the 1993 version of, oh god, I don't want to say it. He was basically just the 1993 Baron Corbin, a jack-of-all-trades heel that they could slot into any position, and it worked, even if that position was fighting for Doinks. He did at least get to go on to be a WrestleMania main eventer against Lawrence Taylor, but unfortunately he never really met the same heights as his contemporaries like Shawn Michaels or Bret Hart, and unfortunately that's all I really have to say on Bam Bam Bigelow, because all I currently know of Bam Bam Bigelow is his work during 1993 Monday Night Raw, which is kind of like knowing Al Pacino exclusively through the film Jack and Jill. So I think I kind of need some help here. So I think we're going to turn things on its head here at Graphic Content. Instead of me telling you why Bam Bam's one of my favorite wrestlers, I need you to tell me why Bam Bam's awesome. Whether that's one of your favorite matches he's had, or moments, or just stories about the Beast from the East. I'd love to study more into the history of the man from Asbury Park, and I know YouTube comments are definitely like the best, most level-headed place to learn. I hope. But there it is, another episode of Graphic Content in the bag, another design under my belt, and another wrestler talked about. But like I said, the conversation doesn't stop with me. What about you, man? Let me know in the comments below what your favorite memories with Bam Bam Bigelow are, and maybe let me know another wrestler you'd like to see a design made for in the world of Graphic Content. And of course, make sure to follow me on Twitter at FightBoysShow to catch up with all my goings on, what I'm doing, where I'll be at, commentating, causing chaos, and generally raising hell throughout the world of independent wrestling. And of course, make sure to hit that subscribe button with a flying headbutt to get some Fight Boys in your feed every single week. And never forget they's them's, ladies and men, that when you are a Fight Boy, you're a Fight Boy for life.